Well, basically, you know, I have a pretty colorful history. My name is Chaz Williams. Basically, I'm from New York. I was born in Harlem, raised in Queens, in Jamaica, Queens, Southside Jamaica. I, you know, have an early history of, you know, having some problems with the law, as it was documented and shown on American Gangster and a few years back. You can also find the bio on the bio channel under Infamous Gangsters. You know, it's a long story, so it's probably best to check that out. But to make a long story short and be concise with it, you know, I started young and getting involved with the law. I did a lot of time in the penitentiary. Wow, I did a total of probably about 20 years. I did probably five on one bid, one term, and I did a 15 on another. So, in federal prison, actually. Well, I mean, you know, well, my history is pretty colorful again in that. You know, I made some history early on when I was in a prison in Milan, Michigan. And, you know, I was, you know, no prison is fun. I want to say that much, but, you know, I came along in my life and made the best out of some of the circumstances while I was incarcerated. You know, some in the early parts was some things that I took advantage of that was against the law, and some that I did later on that was within the law. Well, you know, when I was coming up, basically, I think that the country was in a definitely a different state, you know, in terms of race relationships around the country. You know, it was highly, you know, segregated. And in terms of the hoods or the ghettos or the urban areas, you know, there was more of a unity type thing because of that element, you know. And a lot of things that you know, people don't have to experience now, or a lot of the racial experience that kind of brought us together, the kind of struggles that we had to do coming up, and the loyalty that we had to exhibit to each other to just basically survive. And we all usually had a common enemy, and it wasn't within ourselves. You know, now it's more, you know, the government's indoctrination has kind of more taken hold. You know, they have this, you know, it ain't stop snitching. They have snitch your way out program going on. And basically, these kids, you know, are coming up in a bad time, man. They don't realize their consequences and what they do. They are, you know, basically, you know, just in it for, say, the finance, but can't handle the consequences that come with it. You know what I mean? So, you know, it's an educational situation that is lacking, you know. And I'm not talking about the traditional education system that's, you know, in the school system, because that's always been bad, even back when we were coming up, you know. But it's the self-education part that we're lacking, you know, that the you know, it's they're being raised by video games and rappers and videos and a lot of shit that ain't true. And when they get hit with the reality of, you know, the consequences of what they do, they then scream, I'm not built for that. It's hard to give, you know, advice to steer away from the game. Life advice that I would give, you know, that whatever you do, you know, you got to, you know what you're getting into. You know, research that, you know. You know, to be good at anything, you got to watch the tapes. Even in sports, they watch the tapes. You practice, you do whatever you have to do. You educate yourself thoroughly about what you're getting ready to get into. And if you can't handle that, then don't do it, you know, and stay away from peer pressure. For real, G has nothing to do with how tough you are, how many people you shot, how many people you killed. You know, the real definition of a G is when you get in that room, in that interrogation room, by yourself, you know, alone, like, just don't let it be 48 hours. You know what I'm saying? You know, that's the real definition of a G. You know, if you do the crime, do the time. You don't make mistakes, you make choices. You know, G's make choices, so they know what they do. So when they get handcuffed or put in the penitentiary or in whatever situation that they're in, they handle it. You know what I'm saying? So G has nothing to do, in my book, with how what you do on the street is what you got inside you. You know what I'm saying? Either you was born with it or you better be made for it. The high incarceration rate against minorities has a lot to do with, you know, the theory of, you know, genocide in our community. You know, the theory of that indoctrination. You know, the kids tend to believe that they don't have nothing to live for and they're not going to live beyond the age of 18 or 16 or whatever that indoctrination that the government gives them. So basically, they don't believe that they're going to even live that far, and they don't even educate themselves to deal with the legal parts of the consequences. And that's what I'm talking about. You know, if you can't read, you can't write, and you can't understand law, when you get in that courtroom, them people run circles around them. You know what I'm saying? And the first thing they tell them, you need to plead guilty because you're facing one. If everybody went to trial, there would not be no trials. There wouldn't be all this railroading. The court system would be so backed up, it would be crazy. Educate yourself. You got to educate yourself if you're doing wrong. You got to educate yourself if you're doing right. You get in the courtroom, them lawyers tell you anything. And that has a lot to do with the high recidivism rate. You know, and I'm talking about outside of the poverty and everything else and the lack of, you know, adequate schools and teachers and this new shit about, excuse my language, about, you know, no one gets left behind. So they just push them through school with no really academic, you know, meaningfulness. But I don't think that this country is no poorer than any other country. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, we have to learn to, you know, take what we got or learn to get what you need to get by any means possible, but within the law. I don't believe in the snitches. It's like, you know, before the draft was thrown out, you know, the government used to say, you know, if you ever get captured by the enemy, it's name, rank, and serial number, you know. So my question would be that if you are with any in any organization, with anybody that you are a comrade of, or say you was in the service, and you in Afghanistan, and the Taliban captures you. Taliban captures you. Now they tell you, help yourself. You know what I mean? You're going home. You know, we're gonna let you go if you let us know the position of your company. You know, your platoon. If you let us know the position of your platoon and where they at, we will let you go. Help yourself. And that individual, that soldier, cooperated with the Taliban, what would they call him? You know what I'm saying? So, like, that's my feeling about the snitch. I don't believe in that. You know, you do the crime, you do the time. You can't do the time, don't do the crime. Get a job, we understand. When I finally got out of prison after the 15-year sentence, it's not the sentence, but serving 15 years in prison, you know, I started my own company because it was hard. You know, I was on what they call special supervision, you know, and being on special supervision, the job of the parole officer was to get you back in prison as soon as possible instead of helping you stay out. So you know, I had to create a way because, you know, part of your parole plan is to stay gainfully employed or they would violate you and send you back to prison. So, you know, you would have to come in every week and tell them, let them know what you were doing in terms of seeking employment. And so then they would ask you, well, where did you apply at? So once you tell them that, they would go to the job to call themselves verifying it. But actually, it's the catch-22. You know, imagine the parole officers walking in there with flak jackets on, the badge hanging off their neck, and asking, is so-and-so working here? You know what I mean? So, again, they had a catch-22, so I had to create a situation and a business that they could not interfere with. So I created my own company, and it was Black Hand Entertainment, and I started off as a promotion company and eventually evolved into doing a full independent record label, and I released some records that had some pretty prominent, you know, artists at the time. You know, I had an album called The Black Gangster, you know, which featured Jay-Z, Ja Rule, DMX, 50 Cent, and several other artists from the South, Mac Dre from the West, you know. And, you know, I was the former manager of Foxy Brown. And I don't know what term I would term the relationship with 50 Cent, but I was on tour with him and handled a lot of the business of touring, you know, for him at the time. You know, some people say it was co-management. I don't know what you want to call it, but, you know, I used to work with him also. I guess he got a couple of songs out on it or whatever, but, you know, I basically now still have my record company, and I have some new artists that I manage because I also have a management division. And the new artists are Tayo. He's a rapper who can get it in. And I have another artist by the name of Fab Don, who is on the street buzz level. He's doing this thing right now. Since I've been out, you know, I've always had the prison outreach. You know, I've been back inside the federal prisons this time, you know, on what I call a prison tour, you know, where, you know, I took in, you know, some pretty, you know, good artists, including Ja Rule. He, before he went in, he was going in to the prisons to perform. And, you know, some, you know, New York artists like Maino, Papoose, we've all, you know, we've been in the prisons with, you know, Styles P, you know, The Lox. We've been in prison programs with them. And, you know, I continue to travel, like, around the country and do, you know, gang intervention work. You know, I work with the youths, and not with just the at-risk youth, which are the youth that are at risk of becoming. We work definitely with the high-risk youth, you know, the youth that are getting it in, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, I just try to see if I can give them, you know, any alternatives, because a lot of them guys, they have a lot of good potential, and which is another thing that was lacking as they were coming up, that was in place when I was coming up. It was, you know, the older, experienced guys in the street that came and, you know, gave us, you know, certain direction and certain principles to move by. You know, now, you know, when the advent of, I guess, the crack era came in, it kind of destroyed that. And now the parents are afraid of the youth, you know, so it kind of contributes to that. Something that was missing when I was coming up in the street. And so I try to now substitute that, you know, while I can't get everywhere, which is why I do things like this, you know, to get it, you know, I kind of use my life story as an example and try to, you know, motivate, you know, some of the high-risk youths into really reaching into their potential and doing what they can do. I have several DVDs out that people have done on me. I can't even name all of them, but, you know, all they got to do is Google me, and they can find, you know, those DVDs, the American Gangster episode. You can, you know, check that out. We have a film coming up that which is about, you know, my life story called Inside Out. You know, we have a script and everything. We are in negotiations on how we're going to do that, where we're going to do it, whether it's going to be strictly independent or through a studio in California. But, you know, again, I have the artist that I'm working with, Teo, look out for him. You know, look out for Fab Don, and definitely look out for the movie and anything else that Black Hand brings out. Yeah, we have a website called blackhandent.com. You know, and like I said, the best way to do this is just to Google my name, and you're going to get a lot of information on me.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. It's a pleasure. Anytime.